Good morning. Welcome to worship today. We're so glad to be together to worship God on this beautiful day. It's an exciting time in the life of our church as we present our third grade Bibles today, and we are so excited to do that with our kids, and so that's going to be a good day. Thank you all for those of you who have served either First Sunday Food Drive or with the Blood Drive. Thank you for your service today. We are so grateful. I want to invite you all to sign in. You can either scan the code or go on to our website and share that you're with us. That is also a chance for you to share your joys and your concerns. We'd love to pray with you. And know that you're here. A couple ways to plug in and love, seek, and serve. You can talk to Melissa Gard if you would like to write healthcare workers notes. That's one of our Love Council ways to share our faith and to serve and give back in our community. And to do that, be on the lookout for small group opportunities for Lent coming out. Lent is a month away. It's kind of amazing. You know, January lasts for like 17 years, and then it's like February is over before you know it. And so Lent this year begins March 2nd, and so it's coming up. And so we'll have some opportunities to plug in and have a special time in that season. And then other ways to serve. Next week, Rabbi Modi will be here with KIFA, the Kansas Interfaith Action, and talking about ways to practice justice in the Kansas legislature and how we can be better informed and also organize together and know what is on the agenda and how our voice can be heard. So that's between services next week during the Love, Seek, Serve Hour. You can learn more from Rabbi Modi. And then also there was an opportunity in the newsletter this week for another chance to pack food boxes at Shawnee Community Services. It's just down the road, not too far, but for our neighbors who need food, we're going to add a second opportunity each month. Right now we do it once a month, and we're going to add twice a month. So you can talk to Sherry Lockhart if that's something you'd be interested in, or see more about that on our serve page of our website or the serve section on the newsletter. We'd love to help you connect. If none of those are ways that you see yourself, come and talk to us. We'd love to help you love, seek, and serve. So with all of that being said, let us stand as you're comfortable and join in our call to worship.
Welcome. Open your hearts to God's love this day. Praise be to God who has called us here. Let the words wash over you and offer you healing and hope. Praise be to God who continually blesses us. Place your hope and trust in God. With joyful hearts, we come to worship and praise God who continually blesses and provides for us. Amen.
Remain standing and join in our opening hymn, God of Grace and God of Glory.
God of Grace and God of Glory, on your people pour your power. Crown your ancient church's story, bring its power to glorious flower. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the facing of this hour. For the facing of this hour. Lo, the hosts of evil round us scorn the Christ, assail his ways. From the fears that long have bound us, free our hearts to faith and praise. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage for the living of these days. For the living of these days. Cure your children to your control. Shame our wanton selfish gladness, rich in things that pour in soul. Grant us wisdom, grant us courage, lest we miss thy kingdom's goal. Lest we miss thy kingdom's goal.
While you remain standing, let's affirm our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Without end. Amen.
Beautiful.
I'm so excited to share a special day with you all today. Here at St. Paul's, we have a joyous tradition of presenting Bibles to our third graders as a gift from the congregation each year. This year, we're also celebrating with some of our fourth graders who were unable to participate last year. And as we open this special time together, Will Mildren will share a scripture reading with us.
Our opening scripture comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 19, verses 13 through 15, and says, "Some people brought children to Jesus so that he would place his hands on them and pray, but the disciples scolded them. Allow the children to come to me, Jesus said. Don't forbid them, because the kingdom of heaven belongs to people like these children." Then he blessed the children and went away from them.
Thank you. The Bibles that we are sharing today are filled with more than just stories. Reading and contemplating scripture is one of the most important ways we learn about God, faith, and our heritage as a Christian community. The words of our scriptures belong to us all and speak to us still. They help us to know who we are, how we are to be in relationship with one another, and how we can better know God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit each day. And for this gift, we are thankful, and today we get to celebrate as we share these Bibles with some of our children.
We've already presented five Bibles to third graders at our 9 o'clock service, and one other student, Flynn McCoy, will receive his Bible by porch drop, so I want to include him this morning. And then to the third graders who are here in this room this morning, when you hear your name called, please come forward and then stand on the top step here. Carolyn Millard. Sarah O'Shea.
And as we celebrate our third graders today, I invite all of you here to join in our responsive liturgy. There are some parts for the congregation, the families of our recipients, and our third graders as well. To the congregation of St. Paul's United Methodist Church, just as a young boy Jesus was found in the temple listening, learning, and asking questions of the leaders, may we also work to build a community where our children are welcome wholly and completely as they are, along with their stories, questions, and ideas.
Families of third graders, just as Mary, the mother of Jesus, Eli and Hannah, Elizabeth and Zechariah, and Jochebed, the mother of Moses, all prayed and sang for their children. We encourage you to join your children in this gift, celebrating our scriptures by reading and learning together. We celebrate this moment in our children's growth and faith development, and look forward to reading the words of their Bibles with them as we all continue to seek God as a family. We will encourage their questions and seek answers alongside them and hold them in prayer as they continue to grow.
So, Caroline and Sarah, this was for you all. Just as you're receiving your Bible today, there was a young boy who offered his lunch and shared it that then fed 5,000 people. And with that, we learned something from that boy, and we want you to know that we're going to learn something from you as well. And so, will you respond as it is on the screen?
Wonderful. As you continue to learn and grow in your faith journeys, may God bless you and keep you. And may God's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may God lift your spirit and give you peace. We celebrate you today and will continue to hold you in prayer in the days ahead. Yay! And to close us out, we now have Wesley Millard sharing a closing prayer.
Please join me in prayer. Loving God, we thank you for sharing in this celebration with us today and for gifting us your word so that we may read together and know you more. Please be with this church as we foster a community of grace and hope, and with our families as they work to read and pray together. And with us, we continue to grow in faith with you throughout our lives. Amen.
Thank you so much for celebrating with us. I now invite all of our children to head out with me to Kids Connection, and we look forward to seeing you. Clap everyone out.
So exciting. We start a new series today. God is nowhere, or God knows where. It's on the Old Testament book of Esther. And besides being a fast-paced drama of a story, Esther is the only book in the Bible that never mentions God, not even once. Religion is barely mentioned, even in a couple, there's a couple mentions of Jewish identity, but no prayer, no temple, no allusions to the ancestors of faith. Instead, we're asked to read this story and find God in it ourselves. It's said to be written to the Jewish diaspora in the Persian Empire around 400 BCE, and it's basically a work of fiction, or at least historical fiction. But the bigger part here that we should know is that it is a story to a Jewish people that reminds them of God's favor toward them. It's told in a way that goes sort of in the opposite way you think it will. It's also incredibly entertaining. That was on purpose. How great is it sometimes to watch the powerful people crumble, right, and the humble ones rise? How great is it that the ones we cheer for in this story are the women living in this patriarchal society? And I'm not talking about how things are today. Like, we're talking zero power. Every decision was a life or death risk to go against the status quo for women. It's a story about discerning the will of God when it isn't always easy to know how to do it or what the best thing to do is. And so our deep dive today, we're going to read from Esther 4. But before I do that, I want to summarize chapters 1 through 3 so we know kind of how we got there. We're going to do the whole rest of the book this whole month, and so you'll get the rest of that. But 1 through 3, I want to give us some background on. So we have King Xerxes and his wife, Queen Vashti. And the king gets really drunk and has a fancy party. And it's like, seriously, the entire first chapter is explaining a fancy party and lots of days of drinking. And so exaggeration is a thing in Esther, and it comes up more than once. And King Xerxes then at this party calls for his wife to come to him to be presented at the party to show off her beauty. Like, ugh, right? And Queen Vashti says no. Which is amazing. King Xerxes is royally upset, embarrassed, tyrannical, and banishes Queen Vashti for her disobedience. Of course, because she says no to his request, he automatically feels the need to make a rule for all women everywhere, because if his wife is acting like this, then other women might be acting like this too. So King Xerxes decides to try for a new queen and makes an order so all the women will respect their husbands and every man shall be a master in his own house, because apparently women doing exactly what their husbands say when they are drunk is respectful. It's a gross different time, right? So what King Xerxes orders is sort of this open invitation for all the virgins in the land to come to be considered to be his next queen. And they had to have like a year of makeovers to be eligible. Seriously, there was like 6 months of makeup and 6 months of oils or something like that. And then they would go, and if they pleased the king enough, then they might be the next queen. Right? So we cringe, right? But this is really like today's The Bachelor, right? Like this 400 BCE, this is that show. So this whole Bachelor King Xerxes situation is where we find Esther in our story. She is Jewish, unlike Xerxes, and raised by her cousin Mordecai. But Mordecai told Esther to not tell anyone inside the palace that she was Jewish. And so she obeyed, and she must have been beautiful because Xerxes was pleased, and she became Queen Esther. And a handful of years passed, and she is sheltered, you know, inside the palace. She is obedient. And at the same time, King Xerxes promotes this rash man named Haman to be a powerful member of his team. And Haman has a big ego and a bigger trigger for anger and wants everyone to bow down to him in the streets. And for some reason, Mordecai, remember that's Esther's now secret cousin, refuses to bow to him. And it might be because he's afraid of committing idolatry. And it might be something completely different than that. But whatever it is, he won't do it. And Haman makes this whole proposal to King Xerxes then to basically pay him to off the Jews because of this one Jew, Mordecai, has disrespected him. But what he told King Xerxes is basically that the Jews have their own rules and that you can't control them, and so they need to be gone. So the king goes for it, and they end up declaring this rule that all the Jews were going to be killed. And they sort of rolled the dice on when that was going to happen, and it was a little ways out and not immediate, but the notice went out immediately and into the community. And so chapter 3, we're up to chapter 3 now, ends with this whole city in a state of confusion and fear. So today, let's listen to Esther chapter 4 and see what comes next. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes and went through the city wailing with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, and for no one might enter the king's gate clothed with sackcloth. In every province, wherever the king's command and his decree came, there was great mourning among the Jews, with fasting and weeping and lamenting, and most of them lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's maids and her eunuchs came and told her, the queen was deeply distressed. She sent garments to clothe Mordecai so that he might take off his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. And then Esther called for Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs who had been appointed to attend her, and ordered him to go to Mordecai to learn what was happening and why. Hathach went out to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate, and Mordecai told him all that had happened to him, and the exact sum of money that Haman had promised to pay into the king's treasuries for the destruction of the Jews. And Mordecai also gave him a copy of the written decree issued in Susa, their city, for their destruction, that he might show it to Esther, explain it to her, and charge her to go to the king to make supplication to him and entreat him for her people. And Hathach went and told Esther what Mordecai had said. And then Esther spoke to Hathach and gave him a message for Mordecai, saying, all the king's servants and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law. All alike are to be put to death. Only if the king holds out the golden scepter to someone may that person live. I myself have not been called to come to the king for 30 days. So when they told Mordecai what Esther had said, Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter, but you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this. And then Esther said in reply to Mordecai, "Go, gather all the Jews to be found in Susa, and hold a fast on my behalf, and neither eat nor drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maids will also fast as you do, and after that I will go to the king, though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." And Mordecai then went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. Will you pray with me? God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each and every one of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For God, you are our rock and our strength and our redeemer. Amen. So my friend from divinity school, Claire, is an Episcopal priest in McMinn County, Tennessee. Does that place sound familiar to you? It happens to be the home of a little place in East Tennessee that received global attention this week for its school board's ban of mouse, a Pulitzer Prize-winning graphic novel about the Holocaust and its impact by Art Spiegelman. There has been one of those, you know, like booming rage fests online and on the news about this East Tennessee community banning this book. There are memes and shoutings to the interwebs and the 24-hour news cycle and Twitter threads galore from people literally all over the world. To the whole outside world, this is a clear mark of injustice. The news coming to light the day before Holocaust Remembrance Day of all days. I'll tell you about how my friend Reverend Claire and her congregation responded this week here in a bit. But I want to just name what it was like to realize sort of two narratives were happening at once this week. I was scrolling through social media and seeing this book banning outrage on all platforms. And I was simultaneously seeing my friend Claire responding to her people as a pastor and as a parent. And it made me so grateful for her leadership there for such a time as this. For such a time as this is by far the most remembered and quoted phrase in the book of Esther. And the conversation from which that phrase is pulled here in chapter 4 is pretty remarkable. Remember that Mordecai, Esther's cousin, has asked now Queen Esther to help change the king's mind about the order to kill all the Jews. And Mordecai had told Esther when she first went to win the king's favor to not speak about being Jewish. So it's sort of like Mordecai both wants her to have the power and also wants her to have no power as a Jew again. It's both ways. And Esther tells Mordecai, and Mordecai is incredibly distraught here, right? Grieving before any Jew has died, sackcloth, tears. But Esther tells Mordecai that she can't just go talk to the king. There is a protocol. It takes time. In this case, he hands someone a golden scepter in order for their presence to be welcomed. That's weird, right? And if not, they die. So the risk in going to the king is a big one, right? Even for Queen Esther. And Mordecai does this thing here that really stings. He said if she doesn't do it, she's going to die anyway, because she's Jewish too. This is almost a threat from Mordecai to out her racial and religious identity here, because clearly they've gone a good bit without that coming to light. But he seems certain that this is not only a threat to her people, it's a threat to her own being. And I want you to hear again what he says. "Do not think that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silence at such a time as this, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another quarter." He's saying they're going to be okay. Jews are going to be okay because they're favored by God. "But you and your father's family will perish. Who knows? Perhaps," he says, "you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this." For such a time as this. Now, in part, this call to action feels like this beautiful, passionate pep talk, right? Esther is in power, and it is like the right person at the right time because of who she is and her life experience. She can make this happen. And that is very well true. And I think it's important to remember that Esther didn't ask for any of this. Esther didn't ask for this. For such a time as this, and this is not a problem she created. Mordecai is the one who asked her to hide her Jewish identity. Mordecai is the one who chose not to bow down to Haman for whatever reason. Haman is the one who asked King Xerxes to make an order to kill all the Jewish people. And Xerxes is the one who said, "May it be so." Queen Esther did not ask for this attention or urgency or place in the world. Queen Esther did not cause this problem either. And yet somehow, for such a time as this, she sits. What will she do? How will she respond? Will she risk her own status to rise up and save her people? Well, yes, we find out. She gives Mordecai kind of the business and takes charge and orders Mordecai to gather all the Jews and hold a fast, and she's going to do that too. And after they fast, she's going to go to the king, even though it's against the law. And she says, "If I perish, I will perish." And we end chapter 4 with Mordecai doing every single thing she says. Esther did not ask for this problem to find her, and she did not create it, and yet somehow she was in the right place at the right time and rose to the occasion, created for such a time as this. Now, I want to take us back to East Tennessee. I saw a mom on CNN sharing what it was like to be a parent there in McMinn County. And the anchor tried desperately to elevate her rage, as anchors do, right? And you could tell this mom who was speaking did not ask for this spotlight, but she was the one they wanted to hear from. And the anchor basically said, "What are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it?" And I half expected to receive this emotionalized response that so often comes in stories like these, the outrage and the drama. And then we have, you know, we've done our part when we hear that. And we put away that story in a nice little box, feeling good about the fact that our internal struggle, we feel, was voiced out loud. And they, too, are outraged. And in some way, you know, this mom checked some of those boxes. But she did something else, too. She wasn't just upset, you know, she was so specific in her response about this place where she lives. "What are you going to do about it?" was not answered in broad generalizations or global solutions or mass social media frenzied posts. She said, "Well, I can tell you that the parish I attend, St. Paul's Episcopal Church, is having a community-wide book discussion on mouse." So my heart burst with pride because that's my friend Claire's church. And the woman then shared some more local specific commentary, and that was that. And I later read an opinion article from her, this woman, in an online rural news daily. And it was absolutely fascinating. The summary of the article said, "Instead of raging over mouse, support local people who are fighting the ban." And with this short description: "Plenty of people in East Tennessee are livid over school board's decision to remove mouse from language arts curriculum, but indiscriminate outrage on TV and social media isn't helping the local dissenters who are trying to build a better way forward." So that's the description. This is what she says. "A few minutes before I gave an interview to CNN in response to the McMinn County School Board's recent decision to ban mouse, I received this text from a friend. Good luck. Remember, you live here." I understand exactly what he was saying, she said. I'd been up most of the night organizing my thoughts, searching for a tone and a message that would communicate my outrage and preserve relationships with my neighbors and local leaders. I was about to go live on a global broadcast to denounce the actions of our local school board because, of course, they must be denounced. And yet, I needed those same leaders and their supporters to know that I was not denouncing our community, that I wasn't tapping out. She went on to say, locally, we were just learning the details of what happened as headlines were being written by major news networks across the world. It was bewildering to see how quickly the global response escalated and spread. Do they think we're not outraged too, here in East Tennessee? Do they think we can't speak up and respond for ourselves? Because let me tell you, I lie awake at night before the CNN interview, indulging my own outrage and constructing a commentary that would eviscerate all book ban supporters and signal to the rest of the world that I, too, am ticked off. It would feel good to give in to the outrage, the indignation, the snark. But I let the outrage pass over and through me because I live here. We live here. These are our people. Our schools, our kids. We spend our days relying on the trust and goodwill of our neighbors to make a life here. Neil Gaiman doesn't shop at the Food City downtown. Trevor Noah doesn't volunteer with the local United Way. CNN isn't interested in solutions journalism, and outrage is where relationships go to die. She went on to say, as I lay awake, I remembered that the only side I'm on is the one that keeps the door open to a relationship and one day community transformation. When the rest of the world tires of tweeting, expounding, and publishing op-eds about this ban, I'll still be here, raising a family, living, working, organizing, and praying in a community that has my heart. I've got to be on the side of holding that together. So I'm so struck by this woman's perspective, this parishioner of my friend, this mother and this Christian. I live here, she said. We live here. I sort of winced this week when I saw Reverend Claire share an update on her social media that they needed to close the book discussion of mouse that had to move toward to Zoom because of COVID numbers, but they had to close it and just make it for their community because so many outsiders were trying to join to show their community what was right. I live here. We live here. I can't help but think about these faithful folks at St. Paul's Episcopal Church in East Tennessee. As I think about Esther in chapter 4, because they didn't ask for this urgent crisis, and they didn't create it. But it sounds like maybe they were ready to respond for such a time as this. Why is that? Why did Episcopalians in East Tennessee, and why was Esther so poised to take on their crises? I'd like to think that's where God comes into the story. God isn't mentioned in Esther, but I trust that when it felt like God was nowhere, that God knows where Esther will go with all this. Esther can freely choose her way, but whatever way she chooses, God will be with her through it. I bet she remembers that teaching as she was raised, learning the stories that taught her things like what our scripture from last week, when I pass through the waters, God will be with me. Do not fear, I have called you by name. You are mine. Even though we don't see her faith practice explicitly, we see her trust in the Lord. She says, if I perish, I will perish. You know, I don't have trust like that every day, right? There is some behind the scenes trust for the God who will see us through in Esther. In East Tennessee, that book discussion didn't just pop up overnight. I've seen the pictures of that little parish with masks and blankets outside around fire pits in 2020 until it was too cold. I've seen pictures of them distanced in their sanctuary. I've read Claire's messages of hope for her community. I've seen pictures of them serving. It might even have been with United Way. Trevor Noah was not in those pictures. Regular practice of their faith led them to a relationship with God that would not let them forget that this place means something to them. Relationship with God led to a prioritization of the relationship with people, even in such a time as this. Because you know what? I think for both Esther and those Episcopalians, we get to see what it means to remember where we are and where we come from. God is nowhere, and yet God knows where you are and where you will be for such a time as this. For Esther, her here and her this meant the power she might have through relationship and obedience, which can feel kind of cringy. Or we can think about Esther's transformation, watching her transform before our eyes from the one who does exactly what she is told to the one who tells people what to do. From being led to leading, she trusted that God would be here for her this. For the McMinn County St. Paul's Episcopal Church, for such a time as this meant the prayers and the worship and the neighboring and the serving turned toward a rootedness and a sacredness to the place where they were called to live and to keep on living, trusting that God would be in their here and present for their this long after the world was. So St. Paul's Lenexa, you might not even know what your this is right now. Or you might have a Mordecai making you have a this right now. But my prayer is that we can have the wisdom to act in ways of grace and trust that the Lord will see us through. The Lord knows where we're going. God cares enough not to control you, but to be present in our formation, to continually call us into faithfulness and give us the choice to be faithful, to nurture us in our here and in our this for such a time as this. We worship so we can see this a little more clearly. We read our Bibles like we gifted those kids today so that we learn we can find God anywhere. We join a small group so that we can build relationships with trust that someone's going to send us a text message when we need to remember that we live here and we go to church here and we parent here and we work here when our outrage might have won otherwise. We serve the community together so that we can share God's message of love here and see it out in the places we thought we needed to take it to. Right? We pray so that we can maintain relationship with God's world globally and personally, putting the world back in relationship with God in our minds when things are hard or when things are wonderful. We share our faith so that when the CNNs of the world want us to rage for no reason except to entertain people we don't even know, we have a chance to say that relationship matters with real people here. We practice justice so that a world might exist when books aren't banned because they're hard, because policies are in place, but also because we believe a world is possible when the atrocities of something like the Holocaust that Mouse is about will never be again. For such a time as this, we are called as people of faith. It might not be because we asked for it. We might not have created it. But the relationship we have with God will get us through whatever comes our way. Our job is to nurture that relationship and that identity so that we might be prepared to be right where we are. Not because our participation in religiosity somehow gives us the token toward knowing how to live in the world, but because it gives us the tools to see the love of God already present right where we are. So we can be brave and rise up when the moment is right, or we can be steady and in it for the long haul. But let us never forget that God is there in that. God knows where we are going. God knows where we will be for such a time as this. May it be so. In the name of the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer of us all. Amen. We have a chance to respond to God's word, to respond to what God teaches us through scripture and the stories we hear, the way our faith builds and moves together. And we do that as we listen to music, we do that as we pray, and we do that as we give. I invite you to come and pray lighting a candle. Maybe it's your candle for such a time as this. Maybe it's the candle that acknowledges what here means to you. Maybe it's a candle for St. Paul's Episcopal Church in McMinn County, Tennessee. But it's a chance to pray and to respond. We also have a chance to give. Every week we can give. You can see ways to do that on the screen. And we get to invest in God's mission and what we're about. One of the things that your giving goes toward is our online worship, for those of you who are at home, you know. And I asked this week in the newsletter for folks to send me stories and share about what online worship means to them. And I got to hear stories of people connecting and reconnecting with this church for the first time or after a long time. For folks who it's still not time in COVID for them because of their health or other situations that it's not the right time to be. But I was so just profoundly grateful for the reminder of what God has done and continues to do to make here and this something we'd never had it be before. It spans across time and place and is still meaningful and is a place where hope is found. And so I'm so grateful for that. We are grateful for you all who are at home, wherever you are today. You are with us, and we will light a candle for you today too. So let us go to God in prayer. Let us go to God in generosity.
bless the gifts our hands have brought, and bless the work our hearts have planned. Ours is the faith, the will, the thought. The rest, O God, is in your hand.
Please be seated. This morning for our prayer time, I want to invite you to share in some responses as we pray together. I'm going to offer a prayer, and then I will say, Lord, in your mercy, and I invite you to respond with, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy. Loving and holy God, all around us are signs of your love and your grace, and we're grateful for that love and the care and all the ways that we've been touched by that grace this week, because that grace revives us and refreshes us and makes us whole. It might be really small things like having a steaming cup of hot chocolate after riding down a hill on a sled, or laughing with a friend. This morning, we want to acknowledge how much these small gifts mean to us, and we pray that we will never take them for granted. For in each one, we are reminded of your love and your care and your creativity. So for these gifts that lift our spirits and fill us with joy, Lord, in your mercy. This morning, we pray for our church. We cherish this chance today to pass on to our children the stories of our faith. For generations, faithful people have turned to these stories to learn more about you and about Jesus and what it means for us to be created for love and for joy and for justice. We pray that each child who received a Bible from our congregation will find in them words that will lead them into a life as a faithful witness of the gospel, ready to see, ready to share how you are at work in the world. Lord, in your mercy. We pray too for our world, for the threat of global war, for this seemingly endless pandemic, for the fragility of our planet. We pray that our leaders will take action with integrity and that your peace will enter their thinking. Lord, in your mercy. We pray too this morning for all those that we love, for those who are filled with worry and anxiety and have poured out their hearts to us, or for those who are too afraid to do so, for those who face life-changing decisions that have to be made, for debt that seems overwhelming, for work that seems unfulfilling, and for bodies that are weary. Lord, in your mercy. Remind us to stand still and listen for your whispered words, words filled with your spirit, words measured with hope. Remind us you are always with us. We are never alone. Your spirit fills us and it strengthens us so that we can walk together here and now and be filled with your peace. Lord, in your mercy. Hear us now as we pray with the confidence of your children, the prayer that Jesus asked us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us stand as you're comfortable and join in our closing hymn, Here I Am, Lord.
I, the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin. My the stars of night. I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart. I, the Lord of snow and rain, I have worn my people's pain. I have wept for love of them. They turn away. I will break their hearts of stone, give them hearts for love alone. Who will speak my word to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
I want to share something that happened in the first service today on the way to go light a candle. Henry, he's about this tall, and his big sister got a Bible today, came up to me and said, "Pastor Laura," and I leaned down and I listened, and he said, "The world is going to get better. The world is going to get better." So Henry gets to give the benediction today. Let us go in peace and serve the Lord. The world is going to get better. Amen.
By the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall